MZTV.
Does God play favorites? Of course he plays favorites. His son, Jesus Christ, plays favorites as well. How many disciples did our Lord have? 112? No, only had 12. Why only 12? Because he picked only 12. And among those 12, he had favorites. Peter, James, and John were his closest intimates. They were with him when some amazing things happened, like the transfiguration on the Mount. And even among Peter, James, and John, John is called the disciple whom Jesus loved. So yes, God plays favorites, and I'm going to show you how favorite we are. We are special people among the entire race known as human. As incredible as it may seem, this is the truth. And I'm going to show you how God operates within our little flock. This is Martin Zender. You're at MZTV, your home for encouraging words and sensible sayings when perilous periods are present. And perilous periods are certainly present. I'm positive about that. And you come here for encouragement. And I am here also to get encouragement from you. We draw from each other, and that's the subject of today's video. So I told you about the disciples, and when Jesus goes to the Sea of Galilee, this is really interesting. The Sea of Galilee here in, this is in Matthew 4:18. Listen to this. Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers. They were Simon, his other name was Peter, and Andrew, his brother. They were putting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Do you think that these two guys were the only fishermen that day on the Sea of Galilee? I would guess that there were dozens of fishermen. Yet Jesus has this radar vision. He was walking by the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers. I am willing to bet that he saw dozens of people, but he saw two brothers, Simon and Andrew. And what he's doing here is he's picking out the next rulers of the world. These two gentlemen and their 10 friends will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel during the millennium. What a day this was for those guys. They woke up, they thought it was an ordinary day. Had their coffee, said goodbye to their wives, grabbed their fishing gear, went down to the sea. Little did they know that they were about to be chosen to be the future rulers of the world. That's just fantastic. It's just fantastic. And we are no less chosen to be rulers of the world, but a different world. Peter and Andrew and the others were chosen to rule the terrestrial world, the millennial kingdom on this earth. That will last 1,000 years. We are being chosen out of the entire human race to rule the celestial world. Because Paul says concerning us, that speaking proleptically in Ephesians 2:6, he seats us among the celestials in Christ. And our realm is inherent among the celestials. And so God has been occupied in the last 2,000 years calling out a special people for his name, for the name of his son. His son's last name isn't Christ. Christ is his office, and we will be enchristed. And at that time, at the snatching away, when we are joined to Christ, the body is joined with the head, and then the body of Christ is complete. As blasphemous as this may sound, it's nevertheless true. The body of Christ is not yet complete. A head is not complete without its body. And again, when we are united with our head, then the body of Christ is complete. And then the work of Christ among the celestials begins. But we are to be, are you ready for this? Enchristed. Christ is not his last name, it's his office. Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, the one chosen to do a work. And we have been chosen, like him, to do a work. The only difference between Christ and us, one of the main, a secondary difference. He was the Son of God, came to take away the sins of the world. He died on the cross for all of us. We didn't die on the cross, but we are also sons of God. And we are also to be enchristed. We are also to take the title of Christ when we're snatched away. We will take the title of Christ because we are just as chosen as he was. And one of the differences, he was first. He's always the foremost, but we're part of the body. He is part of the body. We're part of the body that he's a part of. It's wild. I know it sounds wild, and yet it's true. He was first. Scripture calls him the firstborn among many brethren. Brethren, sharing his glory with us to the point that he calls us brothers. Brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, we're special. It's true. God plays favorites. Don't feel bad. It wasn't your plan. Wasn't your idea. You didn't beg to be special. In fact, many of you practically renounce your specialness. A little almond milk to soothe the throat here. You're almost embarrassed to be special. You don't want to be special. Well, I'm sorry, but you are. Let God have his fun. He chooses us in accord with his delight. Ephesians chapter 1. This is his delight. Your delight is secondary. He's doing this because it's fun for him to choose among the human race those who are unwise, weak, ignoble, and stupid, the offscouring of all things. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. It's laid out there in all its beautiful, gory, shocking detail. He chooses the least among the human race. Just as Israel was the smallest nation of all the nations, he chooses that, just like I said yesterday. God's power is made manifest in the smallness, the small groups. God's power is made manifest from the weakness of the cross. The wisdom of God is shown from the weakness of the cross because the conquering of evil is done by spirit, not by the might of human flesh. So how does God work with this body? Well, Paul exhorts believers in Colossians 2:19 to hold the head. That is to always think that even though we may have fathers and husbands and wives, we have a head above all that. We have bosses, supervisors, we have a head, and it is Christ. And we are to hold him as our head. But we're mutually part of the body. Let me get the context. Let's start in verse 18. Let no one be arbitrating against you who wants in humility and the ritual of the messengers to parade what he has seen feignedly, puffed up by his fleshly might and not holding the head, out of whom, capital W, speaking of Christ, out of whom the entire body, that's us, being supplied and united through the assimilation and ligaments, is growing in the growth of God. Now, in 1 Corinthians 12, Paul compares the body of Christ to the human body. And this is anatomical here. When he talks about ligaments and assimilation. Assimilation has to do with the small intestine. It really does. It's an anatomical term. The little villi that line the small intestine, that's what this word actually means in the Greek. Remember, the body of Christ is a figure. It's a metaphor. Or the human body is a figure, a metaphor for the body of Christ. So if the human body is a metaphor, then we're looking at small intestine, large intestine, looking at bones, looking at ligaments. That's mentioned here. And it also mentions that we are being supplied. Someday I'll go into more detail into the assimilation and the ligaments. But for now, the assimilation is that we are getting food from God, like the human body draws food, draws nourishment from the food that goes through the intestines. Those little hairs, they grab onto the nutrients. And we're like the little hairs. We grab on the nutrients that comes from God. Hey, I didn't invent this analogy. I'm struggling to explain it here. And the ligaments are the one version, I think, might say tendons. They hold your body together. Otherwise, you'd be pile of parts, but you're held together with ligaments. And the body of Christ is also held together with spiritual ligaments. Remember, the literal body is being used metaphorically to describe a metaphorical body of Christ. We're united to Him. And the best analogy Paul can give is the human body. Our body doesn't do anything without the head. Yes, the head tells the body what to do, and that's the same thing in the body of Christ. The head tells the body what to do. The body cannot do anything apart from the head, apart from the brain. Christ is the brains of this operation. But we're vital parts of Him. Vital. Now, I happen to know, because of my superior wisdom, that the word supplied here, being supplied and united through the assimilation and ligaments, is the Greek word epichoreagio. Epichoreagio. This is a three-part Greek word. Epi is on. Choreo is chorus. And agio, the last part of that, is lead. So the three English elements of the Greek word here are on, chorus, lead. Now, consider that word chorus. Chorus is a group of people. We think of singers in a chorus, voices together making a melodious sound. They may be on different pitches, different members of the chorus, but they blend together, each in their own way, some the soprano, some alto, some tenor. They mix together and it makes beautiful music. This is the body of Christ. Chorus, choreo, is also the root word of choreography, and this is what I want to focus on specifically. Being choreographed, this is how I want to put this. Holding the head, out of whom the entire body, being choreographed and united through the assimilation, through getting food, getting nourishment from the common source, Christ, and ligaments, were joined together not only with each other but with Christ through spiritual bonds that are just as real as the bonds that are holding the arm bone together with the shoulder bone. We're just as tied to Christ and just as tied to each other, and we're choreographed. A choreographer is someone who directs dancers. Tells the dancers what to do, where to go, when to turn, when to spin, when to flip, when to do this. Grab her here, grab him there, move over here. Here's your spot, do this, and go off stage right now. So, I don't know how many people there are alive in the body of Christ. Not too many. I'm famous for saying that. Let's say there's 1,000. I don't think that's too far off. He choreographs. Now, this is not to say that he doesn't choreograph everybody in the world. Of course, God is God. He's the placer. This goes perfectly. The name God, theos, in the Greek means placer, the one who places things. This goes along perfectly with a choreographer. A choreographer places dancers where they are supposed to be. So we are choreographed by Christ, by the head. We meet each other when we're supposed to meet each other. We talk when we're supposed to talk. I get texts from you, I get emails from you, you hear a word from me, and I don't know how many times somebody has told me, Martin, unbelievable, I was just thinking about this topic and you made a show about it. I was going to write you and say, please make a show on this topic, and you did it. It's like we're of the same mind. Like we're of the same mind? We are of the same mind because our head is Christ. He's a common head. The body is full of different parts, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of parts. There's 200 parts. There's 206 bones, but there's how many cells? Okay, you see what I mean? You can even look at every member of the body of Christ as an individual cell. But they have one thing in common, is they're all taking commands from the head. And so, of course, we're hearing the same thing. And when we get together at conferences, you know how it is. Everybody starts talking, and it's like you've known each other. You meet people you've never met before, and yet it's like you know these people. You know them. It's a phenomenon. I've experienced it every time I've gone to a conference, and I hear the same thing from you. It's like, I know these people. Yes, that's because we have a common head, and we're being choreographed, and we're being supplied by the same source of nutrition. And even though we're independent of each other in a geographical way, we're so far away and we feel isolated and we feel alone. I want you to feel less that way after this presentation, knowing that we're united by ligaments. They're stretching. They're stretching across the miles, but dang it, they're keeping us together. These spiritual bonds that we have. And we're in the assimilation, that is the gathering of nutrition from a common source. This is why we all say the same things. It's not because we're a cult or we're a club. It's that we're hearing from headquarters. We have the same headquarters. We have the same head. I'll just leave it at that. The same head. And that's Christ. And this is a dance. So, of course, God choreographs everybody. But he's specifically saying here, remember, we're his special people. He's a savior of all, but especially of believers. 1 Timothy 4:10. God is the savior of all humanity, but especially of believers. And he's the choreographer of all humanity. That's what this word means in the Greek. Choreograph. On chorus, lead. Leads. He's the choreographer of all humanity, but especially of us. Especially of believers. We're his primary focus now. We're his darlings.
But I'm no good, Martin.
It has nothing to do with it. In fact, it pleases God to do his best for those who consider themselves the worst. That's what God operates. Look at the scriptural precedent. He takes the little and he gives them a lot. Takes the last, makes them first. It delights God to do this. Don't take away his fun, okay? Roll with it. It's good. This is good news. I'm giving you good news. This organism called the body of Christ is alive. You are alive today, sustained every day by God. Your day is written beforehand in his book. And now we find out that our every step, well, we knew that from Proverbs, humans' steps are ordered by God. That goes along with the choreographer too, doesn't it? Steps. But for now, God's favorite people, the body of Christ, he is super directing our steps. That tells me that we can't make a misstep. Absolutely speaking, we can't make a misstep. If you're meant to meet somebody, you will, even a member of the world, somebody who's not in the body of Christ. And when you're meant to have an interaction with a fellow member of the body of Christ, that's a big deal to God. Every time I speak at a conference, one of the first things I say is, this is a big deal what's happening here. At any given time, any conference is the largest gathering of the body of Christ on the planet Earth. I bet the farm on that. It's important to God. We've all been choreographed to be at that spot at that time. But even if we're not together, I want you to be conscious of the fact that you are in a dance. We're all dance partners. You and I, we're dance partners. God and Christ are our choreographers. They know what they're doing. When they move, we move. Even though we're not conscious of it 24/7. We're not. It doesn't matter. God's conscious of it. And he has all the steps written out ahead of time. And so, absolutely speaking, you cannot make a misstep. Let that be a great comfort for you today.